Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Farzana, graduate from FETPB and working as a medical officer in IEDCR. Now it's time for our first scientific session. It's our pleasure to introduce Dr. Zakir Hussain Habib, moderator of this session. He graduated from Rajshahi Medical College, a reputed medical college of Bangladesh, and did his MPhil from Sir Salimullah Medical College. Now he is working as the principal scientific officer and head of microbiology department, IEDCR. With him, Dr. Sohel, a successful FETP graduate, now working as a medical officer at IEDCR, is going to organize the session. Along with them, Dr. Shubhrata, Dr. Farooq, and Dr. Prince will facilitate the online activities. Now I request respected Dr. Zakir Hussain Habib sir to conduct the scientific session. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody from home and abroad. This is the first session of the second day in the first Bangladesh Congress on Epidemiology and Public Health 2021. So yesterday there are several presentations, mainly on the COVID-19. So today some different presentations are going to be held, and in this scientific session there are five presentations. They will be presented one by one. But before going to that, I want to say some basic rules that the presentation time is 10 minutes. At 7 minutes there will be a bell, and at 9 minutes there will be another bell, and after 10 minutes there will be 5 minutes for the question and answer session. The question and answer can be coming from the YouTube or from Zoom, and the audience present here, they can also ask questions. So I like to request Dr. Sharmin Sultan as the first presenter to present his study.
My presentation is on seasonal upsurge of Japanese encephalitis in Bangladesh 2017 and 18. Japanese encephalitis is an arthropod-borne neurotropic flaviviral disease. The virus actually is a single stranded enveloped and positive sense RNA. It is called the Japanese encephalitis virus. The virus usually lies in between the animal host. The exotic cycle actually lies within them, but mosquito act as the vector for this for the transmission. Human and horse actually are the dead end host, and they are incidentally or accidentally infected by the mosquito for this virus. After infection of the Japanese encephalitis virus, most of the human remain asymptomatic, but one out of 300 cases people develop febrile illness to severe meningitis encephalitis. The incubation period ranges from 4 to 14 days. The case fatality rate usually among the severe clinical cases, it is 20 to 30%, and among the survivors, 30 to 50% survivors actually develop long-term neurologic or psychiatric sequelae. The clinical symptoms are usually the fever, altered mental status, new onset of seizure, and facet type of paralysis. The Japanese encephalitis virus actually endemic in the Asian region, and there are about 24 countries are in the Asian regions are endemic for this JE virus. We can show in the map that Asian and Southeast Asian region and the Western Pacific region are the endemic for the JE. The virus was first detected in Japan, that's why it is called the Japanese encephalitis virus. There are about 68,000 cases occurred all over the world every year. The Japanese encephalitis surveillance, actually it is done under the acute encephalitis syndrome surveillance in Bangladesh. The surveillance actually started in 2007 in a small hospital-based surveillance near about 4 or 5 hospitals. But in 2017, we started the surveillance all over the country in secondary and tertiary level hospitals. The surveillance was done by the expanded program on immunization under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, or IEDCR, that is Institute of Epidemiology, Disease Control and Research, is in collaboration with them, and WHO give us the technical support. It is the facility-based syndromic surveillance focused on specific disease which is confirmed by laboratory with active and passive components in it. All district and medical college hospitals are our surveillance sites. For this, actually, this presentation, we analyze the data. For the objectives of this data analysis is to understand the epidemiology and association related with JV virus infection in Bangladesh from June 2017 to December 2018. The specific objective is to characterize the age and gender distribution of the disease, to identify the high-risk geographical areas, to observe the seasonal pattern of JV infection, and to assess the risk factor or association related with the Japanese encephalitis virus. The data actually which is collected from the site, we analyze in Excel spread in the Excel sheet. All the samples are go to the IDCL laboratories, and here we tested ELISA to detect the IgM antibody. And all the data are analyzed in SPSS, and cleaning and processing was done, and sometimes it is also analyzed in the EPINFO also. We follow the case definition which is given by the WHO for Japanese encephalitis surveillance or AES surveillance. It is the acute onset of fever and change in mental status and a new onset of seizure, excluding the simple febrile seizure. Follow the laboratory diagnosis procedure, this is also given by the WHO, the protocol we followed. Regarding the data analysis, we found that among 1,777 samples collected within this our study period, among them 115 were positive for JE virus, and 9 is positive for dengue, and 10 is equivocal. Actually, we exclude that equivocal samples from our positive cases. Equivocal means they are not JE or neither dengue. We have actually near about 103 or 4 surveillance sites. Among them, we found that these are the major areas where we find the AES cases and JE cases. Among the 115 cases, we find that 40% cases were from Russian Medical College Hospital. The age distribution of the positive and negative cases. In this slide, we can see that the JE positive cases, among the JE positive cases, the median age is the 40 years of age, and among the JE negative case, the median age is 40, and median age is 17 years of old. And the age range from JE positive cases 1 years to 95 years, and for JE negative case, it is 0 to 110 years. The age, if we distribute the sex along with the ages, so I have actually not significant differences found, but in the male were predominant in the 0 to 15 years of children and 61 to 75 years of children, but female were more prone in 71 to 45 years of health. The signs and symptoms of JE cases in our surveillance, we find that fever is the most predominant, and most actually 99% of the cases of fever, with the headache, following headache, and coma unconscious, and mild to abnormal muscle tone during examination of the neurological status. And the seasonal distribution of JE in Bangladesh, actually I want to focus in that cases. The bar indicate the AES cases to our surveillance sites, and the line graph shows the positive cases. Here we can see that our data starts from June 2017 to December 2018. So the positive case was actually in the month of October for both the year. And we know that the September to October or November is the post-monsoon period. So JE cases surges in the post-monsoon area season. This is the picture. In this picture, we can see that all the colored area shows the JE positive cases here. We distribute the cases in the Upojela level. Here you can see that the Shibganj Upojela of Rajshahi Division has the most of the cases are from there, and following the other areas. And we can see that JE cases actually distributed all over the country. And here actually the color was more here because data collection is good in these areas. That's why we can see the color is here. But we started surveillance just a few years. So I hope we can increase the data collection from the other side also. The relation of age and occupation with JE cases, we can find some finding here. In our study, we said that the age group more than 15 years old are actually more prone to develop the JE, and the worker, if you find the relation with the occupation, we find then that the agriculture worker are more prone to develop the JE cases. For age, it is ostentatious 2.4. For occupation, the agriculture worker, it is 1.9. Our recommendation is that the study should conduct in high-risk geographical areas, monitor the seasonal trend to detect any outbreak, if there is any, and more variable related to exposure and risk factor should be introduced. And vaccination should started in these areas where consistently higher number of JE cases reported, and regular data analysis and dissemination of the disease condition should continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharmin, for your nice presentation. It is an interesting presentation. So far, we have found two questions for you. Number one is, how can we explain the equivocal test results in the study?
Thank you, sir. Actually, in our data collection procedure, we collect samples on the first day of admission in the hospital and on the 10th day of the onset of symptom. If patient go before that, we collect the sample on the last day of sample collection. So IgM antibody develop, in the first 5 to 7 days after the onset of symptoms. And another thing is that JE is the cross-reactive, gives the cross-reactive result with the dengue virus. So that's why when we test the samples for IgM antibody, it's cross-reactive with the dengue IgM antibody also. So if any patient have dengue, sometimes that patient give a positive result for the JE also. That's why if we usually do JE test first, if all it is JE positive, then we go for the dengue test. If it is dengue positive, then we call it dengue, not JE. So sometimes the antibody gives some result in between. In that case, we will repeat the test. If it is given again the in-between result, then we call it is equivocal. We cannot conclude it as JE or dengue. That's why these are the equivocal cases.
So is there any confirmatory test that you could confirm?
Actually, ELISA, the confirmatory test. Post-reductive neutralization test is the confirmatory test. But in Bangladesh, we cannot do the PRNT test. But we are confirm the test or retest the samples. We send the samples to the regional reference laboratory for Southeast Asian region, that is in Bangalore, and they actually confirm the test by doing the repeat test. And sometimes some of the cases they do the PRNT to confirm some percentage of sample actually.
Okay, I go to the next question. That is, can we correlate JE with dengue in terms of prevalence?
In this study, actually, we are not doing this analysis. But we do the dengue test only for the JE cases who are positive for JE. But invariably, all the samples are not tested for dengue. These 9 dengue, actually, we test first JE. And if they are, we do the dengue test for those positive cases, these are the only that 9 cases. Okay. But we are not doing all the samples for dengue test.
So there are a couple of questions, but I'm taking the Another one for you, for the time constraint. Any piloting of vaccination for J?
We don't have any baseline survey. This is new surveillance. We have surveillance from 2007, J surveillance in Bangladesh, but these are Sentinel Tier 4 sites right there. We started our surveillance in 2017 in Bangladesh for the baseline data. For any types of vaccination, we need the baseline data. This is actually vaccination. This is the platform. This will be the platform. So our plan is to give any pilot study on J vaccination depending on this data. So we are planning actually.
So we are sorry that for the time constraint we are not taking the questions. But if you want to, you have any questions, then you can they can personally contact Dr. Sharmin, I think. So thank you, Sharmin, for your nice presentation for clearing us all the questions. So now I would request Dr. Manjur Hussain Khan. Dr. Manjur Hussain is a virologist. He's an assistant professor, virology department of IDCR. He's going to present epidemiology of circulating human group A rotavirus genotypes in Bangladesh during 2018 to 2020. Dr. Manjur Hussain.
Respected moderator, learned audience online and also in the hall room. Assalamu alaikum and very good morning. I am Dr. Manjur Hussain Khan from Department of Virology IDCR. Welcome you all to my presentation of epidemiology of circulating human group A rotavirus genotypes in Bangladesh during the year 2018 to 2020. Diarrhea is one of the leading causes of under 5 years of mortality in Bangladesh, and according to WHO Bangladesh data profile of 2015, it is found that around 7,000 children of under 5 years of age died due to diarrhea, which is equivalent to 16% of total under 5 death in Bangladesh. And for the rotavirus diarrhea, it is the most common cause of severe diarrhea in children worldwide. And overall, rotavirus accounted for more than 5 lakh deaths annually, or 29% of all deaths due to diarrhea among under 5 years of children. And in Bangladesh, we found that 64% of children under 5 years of age admitted with acute gastroenteritis had evidence of rotavirus infection, and majority of them, that is around 58%, is under 1 year of age. And if we consider under 2 years of age, it is around 86%. And for group A rotavirus genotypes, it is a member of the family Ruviridae, which is a 11 segmented double-stranded RNA virus. And due to this segmented nature, we found that its genome allows it to adopt remarkable genetic diversity. It encodes around 6 structural proteins, that is from VP1 to VP4, VP6, and VP7, and also non-structural proteins NSP1 to NSP6. And based on this VP7 gene, it is classified into G genotypes, and on the basis of sequence of VP4 gene, rotavirus, they are classified into P genotypes, P genotypes. And currently there are around 36 G types and 51 P types have been reported worldwide. The most common G or P genotype combination causing 90% infection in humans are G1P8, G2P4, G3P8, G4P8, G9P8, and G12P8, and vaccination is an effective measure to combat rotavirus infection. And the government of Bangladesh also considering to start rotavirus vaccination in national immunization program. In this regard, I want to mention about the hospital-based rotavirus and intersuspension surveillance in Bangladesh, as our samples are collected from this surveillance platform. SBRS has a journey of around 10 years, which started in July 2012, and we have IDCR and ICDF started this surveillance with technical support from USCDC. In September 2017, there is a transitional plan to take over the surveillance activities by IDCF with technical support from WHO. And in January 2018, started laboratory testing at IDCF Virology Lab. And in February 2019, IDCF took hold of the surveillance activities. And SBRS covers actually 7 divisions of Bangladesh. And includes sentinel sites, both the government and non-government hospitals. The objective of our study is to identify the circulating group rotavirus genotypes in Bangladesh during 2018 to 2020, and to identify the circulating genotypes in different age group, gender distribution, and also geographical distribution. We included 445 samples, and our specimen type was stool. The samples were selected from cases who were positive for group A rotavirus antigen by enzyme immunoassay. The samples were selected from SBRS surveillance platform, and study period is 2018 to 2020. This is the step of how the surveillance is conducting. We first screen the screening by the field assistant following the case definition of rotavirus suspected cases, and enroll every fourth child, and our, there is the data collection by service physician, and also sample collected by field assistant, and then there is sample and log seq transportation to IDCR, and first we test rotavirus antigen, and a total of 20 to 25% of the rotavirus antigen positive samples representing all age group, gender, and geographic location were selected for genotyping. These are the results. First, if we consider the genotypes of rotavirus, there are circulating strains in Bangladesh are G1P8 followed by G3P8 and G9P8 during the year of 2018 to 2020, and we have also G2P4, G9P4, G12P6, and also G12P8. And this slide shows about the, in each year, how the circulating strains are we found. In 2018 and 2019, we found G2P4, but in the 2020, we do not find G2P4, but we found G12P8. Rotavirus genotypes according to different age group, there are circulating strains are found in all age groups, so there is no variation. And regarding the genotypes according to gender, we also found that there is no variation in the genotype that is available in Bangladesh or circulating. And now according to, in case of geographical distribution, it is also found that G1, G3 is found in all divisions of Bangladesh. One thing is found that in Sylhet division, we found G2P4, which is absent in other divisions. And this slide actually shows the previous literature review and also our findings. There is, in 1994, there is actually the G4 is G4, and 2004, there is also found G1 and also G9. In 2014, the main circulating strain is G12, but after that, we found that G1 and G3 are now, now we have found G1 and G3. So if we conclude, the circulating rotavirus genotypes in Bangladesh are G1P8, G3P8, G9P8, G12P6, G12P8, G9P4, and G2P4. There is no significant variation of these genotypes with the age group, sex, and geographical location. G2P4 is found in 2018 and 19, but absent in 2020. G12P8 is found in 2020, but absent in 2018 and 2019. Up to 2014, G12 is the predominant genotype in Bangladesh, whereas in from 2015, G12 is replaced by G1 and G3. Recommendation, rotavirus vaccine should be selected on the basis of circulating strains in Bangladesh. I do acknowledge DGHS Director IDCR and our surveillance team at WHO. Thank you.
Uh,
I'm Dr. Nusrat from IDCR. Dr. Manzoor, for your nice presentation on rotavirus genotyping. So my question is from the 2018, the genotype is changing and more genotype is Z138 and Z3P8. So is there any impact that the vaccination that we are providing our babies now, that oral vaccine for rotavirus, do we have to think again that we have to change the pattern of the vaccination, or how this genotyping is going to impact the decision regarding public health or vaccination issues?
Thank you, Dr. Nusrat. Actually, our we need the vaccination strain, that we need the circulating strain in Bangladesh for vaccine selection. And now as the G1 and G3, this is the most prevalent genotypes in Bangladesh. So we have to select this type of the vaccine that includes these genotypes. Otherwise, we cannot find any effective vaccination. So in 2015, there is another study, and that time G12 is the predominant type, but we introduce a vaccine that is not that does not include G12, only a slight percent. So that is a failure of the vaccine. I think on that is about 40% around. But now, if we select that vaccine, this is effective according to this study, because it covers around 86% of the circulating strain.
Yeah, actually, most of the people, they have the same question in their mind, because the correlation with the vaccine strain and what is the strain is prevailing in our country. And I think the surveys should go on so that we can know which strain is prevailing, and so which vaccine we can choose. So Dr. Manzoor, there are some other questions. How the sample size was estimated in this study?
Actually, for the surveillance, this is part of the surveillance of SBRS, and we have actually the positive samples every quarter, every 3 months. We selected the positive, we considered the positive samples, and from these positive samples, we already doing genotypes for 20 to 25%. Actually, this represents the whole of the country, because we select the samples representing all geographical area, age and sex also.
Okay. Now another question from our audience, Dr. Sharmin.
We are giving the rotaviral vaccine in Bangladesh long term, and we also do the surveillance side by side. Is there any vaccine efficacy study in our country with this vaccine?
Actually, this vaccine is not introduced in a routine immunization program of government. The vaccine that is available is the private sector.
Yes.
So I think there is no vaccine efficacy study yet, because we are not even starting the vaccine in our immunization program.
Okay. Thank you.
Another question is that any implication of different genotyping for plan strategy of vaccination? That is the same question, I think.
Yeah,
Is there any clinical significance of this genomic vaccine in last 10 years? Short.
Actually, there is no, the virus, the rotavirus infection, there is some vesicary score we call the clinical assessment, and it thinks there is no variation in the genomic diversity with the clinical assessment or clinical finding. All are same. Actually, they are actually presenting with vomiting, diarrhea, and some severity of diarrhea or dehydration status. So there is no actually clinical findings and genomic diversity. There is no variation.
I think if there is any relation with the genotype and the severity of the disease, is there any study like?
We do not have any study now yet, but
okay. Another question is that which age group are more affected with rotavirus? This question was asked from Department of Population Science, Dhaka University.
Which age group? We already say in our slide that 56% is from under 1 year of age, and if we consider under 2 years of age, it is around 86%. It is from our surveillance findings from the last 10 years.
Thank you. Now I like to ask if anybody is there from the audience would like to have any question. So thank you, Dr. Munjur, for your nice presentation.
Thank you all.
We are going to the subsequent presentation. That is Dr. Roshan Jahan Akhtar Alo is going to present. She is the director of DGHS, assistant director of DGHS. She is going to present on investigation of a diarrheal outbreak among tea garden worker, Moulvi Bazar 2018. I would like to request Dr. Roshan Jahan Akhtar Alo.
Thank you, sir. I am Dr. Roshan Jahan Akhtar Alo, assistant director at DG Health. Previously, I worked in IEDCR at 2017 and 2018 as curator and also a frontline FETPB. Assalamu alaikum and a very good morning to everybody. Now I present investigation of a diarrheal outbreak among tea garden workers, Moulvi Bazar 2018. Diarrheal outbreak in Bangladesh. During 2013 and to 2018, National Rapid Response Team investigated 21 diarrheal outbreaks. The map shows the location of outbreak. Notification of deaths due to diarrhea. We notified September 20, 2018, two deaths in Srimangal Tea Garden State. First, September 5, 2018, first death due to diarrhea, and second, September 20, 2018, second death due to diarrhea. We notified by Upojala Health and Family Planning Officer who informed IDCR, and simultaneously National Rapid Response Team started the investigation on September 20, 2018. That means same day. Then initial verification of deaths, both of them were tea estate garden workers. Up to September 20, 2018, 190 diarrhea patients took care in emergency department of Srimangal Upajala Health Complex. So we decide objectives of investigation. To investigate the two diarrheal deaths in Srimangal, to verify the existence and the extent of the outbreak, to identify the source of the outbreak. Methods of investigation. Our investigation period 20 to 26 September 2018, verbal autopsy of two deaths, and we decide Srimangal Upajala Health Complex, review hospital records, interview hospital admitted patients to identify the place of investigation. Then we decide case definitions, suspected case, any resident of Bhurbhuraiya Tea Estate. Bhurbhuraiya Tea Estate is one of the tea garden of Finlay Tea Estate, having passage of three or more loose stools in 24 hours since September 21, 2018 to September 26, 2018. Confirmed case, any suspected case with laboratory confirmation of the causative organism. Here are some pictures. Laboratory testing. Initial rapid deep stick test, Vibrio cholerae 01, Vibrio cholerae 0139. Culture sensitivity of stool samples and tested at Institute of Epidemiology, Disease Control and Research. Water samples tested in Institute of Public Health. Findings of verbal autopsy of two death. Case one, 55 years old male day labor, married man, regular drinker, resident of Bhurbhuraiya, Srimangal. September 5, 2018, sudden onset of diarrhea and vomiting. initial treatment at local Tea Garden Health Center. Was referred to Sri Mongol Upajala Health Complex but died on the way. Case 2. 52 years old male tea garden worker, married smoker, resident of Burburaya, Sri Mongol. September 18, 2018, sudden onset of diarrhea and vomiting, received ORS and admitted to local Tea Garden Health Facility. September 20, 2018, referred to Upajala Health Complex, Sri Mongol, and died on the same day. This is a EP curve of diarrhea of Burburaya from August 17 to September 24, 2018. Here we see diarrhea starts last of the August and it continue whole of the September. And during investigation we watch that a silent outbreak of diarrhea occurred around the year. But they don't notify us. Age group distribution of diarrhea patients of Burburaya from August 17 to September 24, 2018. Here we see most of the diarrhea occurs below 50 years age of patient. Hours of drinking water sources within 24 hours prior onset of diarrhea, Burburaya 2018. Source of drinking water. We see there are three sources of drinking water, Mondup supply line, Purbasha supply line, and tube oil. And we see Mondup supply line is 3.7 times more affected than others. Here, picture of unhygienic condition of the tea garden quarter. Laboratory findings, initial rapid deep stick test, one stool sample tested positive, culture sensitivity within 4 to 2 samples are positive for Vibrio cholerae. Water sample test, 7 samples are tested in reference lab. Conclusion, diarrhea outbreak in Burburaya might be due to Vibrio cholerae, most likely associated with contaminated supply line water. Death occurred probably due to late presentation and poor resuscitation of the patient. Recommendations, to ensure the supply of safe water in the outbreak area, to aware people about safe drinking water, to train the healthcare workers of Tea Garden Health Facility on resuscitation of diarrhea patients. Acknowledgement, Sri Mongol Upajala Health Complex, Health Facility of Tea Garden. Thank you everybody, thank you for patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Alam. Yeah. Actually, the most of the outbreaks that we present at IDCR, most of the is a diarrheal outbreak due to different organisms, and it is a bit unique because it is the outbreak was in the tea garden. So we have some questions online, and before going to online, I would like to ask questions from the audience if anyone is like to ask any question. Dr. Sharmin.
Thank you, Dr. Alu, for your nice presentation. I have one question for you. We know that diarrhea is common in our country, and every year we have some diarrheal outbreaks there. So is there any intervention done after this outbreak in that area for next year?
Yes, we do some things. We recommendations points, but we try to facilitate their safe drinking water, and we serve around 150 tube oil deep turmoil. And I know Bhurbhuraiya Tea Garden has no water problem now at time. And I visit them last year. They were very much happy for safe drinking water and also toilet. They have no toilet, but now they have few number of toilets.
Thank you. Actually, this is very important. We do lots of outbreak, but intervention is very, actually, intervention is more required for this type of outbreak, after the outbreak. Thank you.
Yes, I try my best to serve this IDCR and from Ministry of Health and Family Planning.
So it's very nice to know that after the outbreak, we have taken some measures so that the diarrheal incidence will be reduced in future times. Thank you, Dr. Alo. Now we have some questions from online. First question is that, can you describe the living condition of the tea garden workers?
Tea garden workers are a group of neglected people in our society. They work hard from morning to evening and earn a lot of money to our society and strengthen our economy. But their lifestyle is so miserable. They have poor and few health facility, and they have a poor educational facility, and they are totally isolated group of people in our country and in our society. This is the health condition and the nutritional condition of tea garden workers.
The next question is that, is this the first diarrheal outbreak investigated by National Rapid Response Team in tea garden workers?
Yes, this is the first outbreak investigation by National Rapid Response Team in tea garden workers.
But as you have mentioned that they are very poor and their sanitation and sanitation condition and the drinking water facility was a bit poor before you investigated. So the last question, there is another question is related to that is, do you think they have other outbreaks not reported in health system?
Sir, please again.
Do you think they have other outbreaks not reported in health system?
Other outbreaks, they really don't any report to from their society. This is reported from Upajala Health and Family Planning Officer Sri Mongol. So that two deaths were in Upajala Health Complex. They don't report, but we should ensure their reporting system.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Is there any more question from the audience? So if there is no question, then I would thank Dr. Alo for his nice presentation. And we are going to the next presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Last but not the least, our presenter is from veterinary side, Dr. Muhammad Ghazi Shah Alam. He's the FETPB graduate from fourth cohort, and he's a veterinary surgeon working in DLS, and he's going to present use of antibiotic in broiler chicken farms, Narsingdi, Bangladesh, August 2019. Very time-honored presentation. I would like to request Dr. Ghazi.
Thank you, sir. Hello and good morning to all. This is Dr. Ghazi Shah Alam, FETPB graduate, currently working in Department of Livestock Services as veterinary surgeon. Welcome to my presentation on use of antibiotic in broiler chicken farms, Narsingdi, Bangladesh, August 2019. In background, poultry is the second highest meat protein source. 35% of global meat production comes from poultry. For maintaining health and productivity of poultry, there are some common practices among farmer communities globally, which is poultry is the second highest meat protein source. 35% of global antibiotics come from poultry meat. For maintaining health and productivity of poultry, there are some common practices among poultry farmers. That is use of antimicrobial when their chicken getting sick, use of antimicrobial to prevent poultry diseases, and use of antimicrobial sometimes to increase their growth. Global antimicrobial use, over 60% of antimicrobial global antibiotics are used for the poultry and livestock production. Estimated that 67% of antimicrobial use for animal food production between 2010 increased 67% between 2010 and 2013. Global average annual antimicrobial is estimated 148 milligram per kg chicken production. One study in Canada found that 81% antimicrobial in use in broiler chickens. Among them, 48% is used for the with the animal feed. Monitoring antimicrobial use is essential to mitigate antimicrobial resistance. In Bangladesh, there is a lack of antimicrobial use data in animal health sector. It is because of the there is absence of surveillance in the animal health sector, and also there is paucity of research in this sector. It is good news that Bangladesh banned antimicrobial use in animal feed from 2010 by enacting the Section 14 of the law Fish Feed and Animal Feed Act 2010. Objective of our study was to describe the antimicrobial use practice in broiler chicken farms in North Sindhi district of Bangladesh. In specific, to calculate the antimicrobial use prevalence in North Sindhi district of Bangladesh, to list the most common antimicrobial, to identify the antimicrobial prescriber, and to describe the perception behind antimicrobial use. Methods. It was a cross-sectional study, but antibiotic use data we collected by visiting the farms once a week for 4 weeks. At first, we went to the contract seller to list the contract seller of 4 opajal of North Sindhi district. Then we collected their contract seller farms list from them who started farming from 16 to 26 August 2019. Then we went to the farm to take their consent to participate in the study. This is the map of North Sindhi district, and here we can you can see the Shibpur Upazila is the highest poultry rearing in this district, and we selected the farm from these 4 upazilas of North Sindhi district. Data collection. Data collected by face-to-face interview with the farmers and by observing the farms once a week for 4 weeks from the beginning of a farming flock up to the selling. In this photograph, you can see that one farmer is signing his consent paper. Brooding. Brooding is the care of young chicken by giving the best environment during the early years of chicken. In practice, farmers maintain 7 to 12 days brooding period in Bangladesh. Contract seller, also called sometimes dealer locally, can be defined as who provide credit to farmer to buy feed, chicks, and medicine from him, and all his contract sellers sometimes bound to sell their product to him. In descriptive finding, we found that 97% were male, 76 had a second occupation beside farming, 73% of farmers studied primary education or above, and average farming experience was 6.9 years. Was raising birds from 5,000 to less than 1,000 birds. So most of the farmers were small-scale farmer, and you can see between 1,000 and 2,000 birds reared by 54% of farmers, and only 5% farmers reared over 2,000 birds. Antimicrobial use pattern in flocks. No farmer had training on antimicrobial use. All 37 farmers used 3 or more antibiotics to rear chicken. And we identified 24 different antibiotics from 14 antimicrobial groups used in this farm. Here are some pictures of antimicrobials that are used in poultry rearing in a study area there, which is tylosin tartrate, neomycin and doxycycline used combinedly, chlorpheniclone, tetracycline hydrochloride, trimethoprim and sulfonamide also used combinedly in poultry, and refloxacin. We listed the top 5 most commonly used antimicrobials in these farms in North India district. That is tetracycline, used by 86% of farmers, penicillin used by 76% of farmers, colistin used by 60% of farmers, sulfonamide used by 54% of farmers, and ciprofloxacin used by 41% of farmers. Purpose of antimicrobial use in broiler farms in North India district, mostly for the prevention purpose, 53%, and 47% farmer was using this antibody for the treatment of their sick birds. 19% antimicrobial use even was critically important antimicrobial for human. You see in this picture, it is colistin, which is used mostly during first week of farming by the farmer. Here also the gentamicin sulfate, azithromycin, ciprofloxacin, all these three also used by the farmer, which is critically important antimicrobial for human. Most used antibiotic in the farm, we already told that 60% of farmer used colistin during first week of farming, also used ciprofloxacin for their farming. Both of these are very important and essential antibiotic for human. Why they use these two antibiotics in the poultry farm? We want to know the pattern of these two antibiotics. So we can see in this graph that most of the farmer use colistin for the prevention purpose. And ciprofloxacin also used highly for the prevention purpose. If we distribute that the colistin and ciprofloxacin used in food waste farming, we could see that over 60% of colistin used for the first week of farming was higher than other weeks. And ciprofloxacin mainly used during the second and fourth weeks of farming. We asked the farmer, why do they feel that they need to use the antibiotics? 88% of farmer answered that antibiotics helps to prevent their poultry death, and 43% think the antimicrobial helps to increase their farm's profit. We collected antibiotic suggestion pattern from our observation. We found contract sellers suggested 78% of antibiotic use event, whereas farmers suggested 18%, and registered veterinarian suggested only 4% of the prescription. In conclusion, we can say contract seller and farmer were taking the decision on which antibiotic to use and where to use. Here is a picture of a contract seller. And most of the contract seller and farmer prefer to use colistin during the brooding chicks. Here is the pack of colistin. They describe it is the brooding, using the brooding purpose. In our recommendation, we established AMU surveillance. We recommended to establish AMU surveillance in the animal health sector and generate policy on use of critically important antimicrobial in humans. Also, we recommended arrange motivational training for the farmer and contract seller and perform a robust study across the country to generalize our finding of the study. We acknowledge farmer and dealer of the North India district and following listed organization to help during our study. Thank you for patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Alam. It was a very interesting presentation. And
actually the antibiotic use in broiler chicken, it is a very burning question, and it is very good to know that government has banned the use of antibiotics in the poultry feed, but still the antibiotics is using as it is also, I think it is also banned for as a growth promoter, but it is about the practice of farmers of using antibiotics has not been changed. We can see in this in your presentations, and it is alarming that all farmers used more than three antibiotics. More than three antibiotics. It's
yes,
very, very alarming. So I'd like to ask from the audience if anyone have any question regarding the presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Gaji. AMU is the most important issue in Bangladesh, and you have done a good job in your study, and I have a question. Dr. Gaji, would you please let me know what is the selection criteria, that means inclusion criteria of your farm selection in the North Sindh district?
Thank you, Dr. Shahidul, for a good question, valid question. Actually, we already showed that at first we selected the four upajala of North Sindh district out of six upajala. Then we went to all the contract seller who contracted their broiler farms. In Bangladesh, mostly contract seller contracted all the broiler farms. So we went to contract seller to find the list of their contracted farms who are starting farming between 16 August to 26 August 2019. That means in these 11 days who started farming, we took all the farmers in this four upajala. Thank you.
Okay.
I like to say that while you are questioning, please give your name and
I am Dr. Mohammad Shahadat Hussain. I just completed my FETP and now working at DLS. Thank you, Dr. Gaji Shah Alam, for your nice and informative presentation. My question is like Dr. Khokon, Shahidul Islam Khokon, that you selected farms from the contract sellers.
Yeah.
We know that in our country, the contract sellers, that means the shopkeepers, those who are selling feed, chicks, and medicines, they are the big prescriber. If you take farms list from those contract sellers, is it not biased? That if you want to bring the percentage of prescribing authority, or who is prescribing the antibiotics or drugs, then you will find most of the prescriber will be the contract sellers. If you could took the list from the Upazila Livestock Office or other sources, then you could got it more or less non-biasedly.
Okay, thank you. It is also a good question. You know, in Bangladesh, it is common practice. Most of the broiler farmer take their chicks, feed, and medicine from the contract seller. They are all the small-scale farmer, and they have the fund crisis, so most of the farmer go to the contract seller to start a farming because he helps to establish his house, he helps to giving him chicks, feed, medicine, all the supports. So most of the farmer is contracted by a contract seller. That's why we think if we want to take the contracts, most of the farmer in our study, because we have limited time. And only we took the farmers who started farming within 11 days. So that's why you go to them. I think it will not make any bias because we don't ask them who prescribe you. We observe the prescription pattern. We go to the farm once a week for 4 weeks. And every in each week we took his, we recorded from his register. We see their medicine list. And sometimes we asked them, So by that way, we collected the information to minimize the bias. Thank
you. Okay, I understand. Thank you.
So it seems that the contract sellers lend money to the farmers, and nothing else. They are not veterinarian or they are not a technical person.
Yeah, all the contract sellers are not technical person.
Technical person. In that case, they have lent money, so they, for the ensuring the security of the money, they advise them to give more antibiotics.
Right.
Isn't it?
Maybe, but we do not actually interview the contract sellers. So our focus was the farmers. So most of the farmers, and by seeing their record, we found that most of the antibiotics suggested, that is 80% antibiotics suggested by contract seller.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question.
Another question is from the audience.
Okay, please, sir.
Ask you a question. Okay, sir.
Okay, Dr. Ghazi, thank you for your nice presentation. Myself, Dr. Ghazi Tahmina Kurim, an FETPB fellow from 5th cohort. So from your presentation, we found that only antibiotics are used for only two purposes, like prevention and treatment. From the very beginning, we know that normally in poultry farm, there are three types of antibiotics are used for three purposes. So what do you think about growth promotion? Didn't you find any farmer that they are used their antibiotics on poultry for growth promotion? Thank you.
Thank you so much. We asked the farmer that to know the answer that, are you using antibiotics for growth promotion or increase the weight of the chicken? Most of the farmer answered they didn't do this, and it is frankly speaking, but they use antibiotic like tetracycline in the almost all around the farming period. So under those use of tetracycline all over the farming system, farming time, it is sometimes used for the growth promotion. They don't know what is the purpose of using this, but my feeling is they are using the tetracycline because it helps in promoting the growth. But legally, using antibiotic in the feed is banned in Bangladesh, so no antimicrobial can be used in the feed, but antibiotic using in the water is not banned yet. So sometimes they transform their practice from using the rather using in feed to the using in water.
Do you have any national data on this regard?
I already told you that there are
maybe I missed it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It is a very interesting issue whether they use antibiotic for growth promotion or not. So I think they know that it is prohibited and it should not be disclosed to anybody out from outside. But you could have asked the question like this: do you think that antibiotic can promote growth in your chicken? Then they may have told you that what they think about the antibiotic. Then you will have an idea what is about the thing.
Yes,
but
we
you have said that they are using most of the period they are using antibiotics.
Yeah, right.
So antibiotics, but that may be for the prophylactic use.
Right.
In that way, they are using antibiotics. So I think it may be a short study, but it is a very, it gives us the insight about what is going on in our poultry field. So thank you.
Thank you, sir.
For your nice and interesting presentation.
Thank you, sir.
There is another question, sorry.
Thank you, Dr. Ghazi. It's a very nice presentation and very important presentation. So I have some few comments regarding the question. One is like you mentioned about the common antibiotic. Have you tested the resistant pattern of those antibiotics? First one. Second, what percentage of farmers actually use antibiotic prescribed by the qualified physician?
Well, we see the resistant pattern, but I didn't show any AMR-related information there. I only used the antimicrobial use pattern-related information right. in this presentation. And second question, please.
So actually, what percentage of farmer using the antibiotic prescribed by qualified
thank you. I already showed in the
20% you told, but
no, it is 4%. Only registered veterinarian uses 4% prescription.
Okay. Yeah. Then, what was that pattern of antibiotic prescribed from the qualified? It is similar that farmer are using.
No, it is different because right. We see that no prescribed registered veterinarian use colistin in their prescription. And sometimes they use ciprofloxacin. Can you please slideshow again? I have an extra slide. That we analyzed the prescription that we found no registered veterinarian use colistin in their prescription. Most of the colistin suggested by right. contract seller and sometimes by farmers.
Informal sector.
Yeah.
Right. Third question is that do the farmers, any percentage of farmers know the consequence of using antibiotic or not? Have
you
asked any question?
Yeah, most I asked them why do they feel they have to use antibiotics, and 88% farmer answered that because it prevents chicken death, and 43% think that it helps to profit their increase their profit in farming.
Okay, have you analyzed anything between knowledge level and antibiotic use or like the this kind of thing?
Yeah, I didn't show it in this presentation.
That's really like lots of things. Need to focus on that. Say who are using, what about their knowledge level and experience, mostly influencing factors and consequence. So
right.
if you want to complete this in a package, that will be great paper for policy implementation.
Thank you for, Thank you so much. Nice suggestion.
Thank you. Actually, the discussion was very nice and it can go, but we have time constraint, so we have to stop it here. So thanks for your nice
you,
presentation
sir.
And the discussion was lively. So we are almost at the end of our sessions. So today in the scientific it was the first scientific sessions, and there were scheduled five presentations, and unfortunately one has not been held due to the sickness of the presenter and. I found the four presentation, all of the four presenters very interesting. From the first presentation, it was the seasonal upsurge of Japanese encephalitis in Bangladesh, presented by Dr. Sharmin. Japanese encephalitis, it is not very much prevalent in our country, but it is a deadly disease. And actually, human is not the main host. Human is the dead end host. Accidentally, human is attacked by this organism. And as we have found from the presentation of Dr. Sharmin, that only 7% J is there after their test, only 7% J is positive. Then others are not J positive. And 92% of J negative cases are still unknown. I don't know whether they are exploring that, whether these things are, what are the organisms. And mortality is quite high, 20 to 3%. And the endemic districts like where the Shibganj Upojela of Chapainavganj and Nagarkanda, they are quite different situation in Bangladesh, but these are most patients came from these areas. So although the prevalence of this disease is a bit low, but for the dead, as it is a deadly disease, a coming disease, so we should have a high vigilance on Japanese encephalitis. So it was an important study. And followed by this presentation, there was a presentation by Dr. Manjur Hussain, Epidemiology of Circulating Human Group A Rotavirus Genotypes in Bangladesh during 2018 and 2020. So rotavirus, we all know that rotavirus is the main cause of diarrhea in up to five years. And there is also a vaccine, but the problem is that vaccine do not cover all the strains. So the study shows what are the strains prevailing in our country, and for the perspective of vaccination, it is very important so that we can know which one is circulating and which vaccine should we should include in our vaccination program. And the third presentation was also investigation of diarrheal outbreak among tea garden workers in Mumbai Bazar. It was presented by Roshan Jahan Alo. The first thing is in that presentation is that we have came to know that after the outbreak investigation, they have taken some measures so that the diarrheal outbreak we can understand that it will reduce. It is very assuring. So thanks to Dr. Alo. And the last one is the use of antibiotics in broiler chicken farms nursing the Bangladesh, and it is showing us the grim sequence of scenario of the antibiotic use in the poultry sector, because I have collected some of these, like all farmers are using three antibiotics, and colistin is used by 60% farmers, as he has revealed. Colistin is our reserve drug in human, and it is used by 60% farmers. It is very alarming. And the they are also using the colistin as prophylactic for colistin and ciprofloxacin. These two drugs are also used in human cases. So it is a bit alarming, and the policymakers should take measures about this. And we have also found that as the contract sellers are poor farmers the money so that they can go on farming. So most of the presentation was very interesting. So I think, Doctor, this is all from my part.